faculty, students, parents, alumni, esteemed members of the Board of Trustees, and the man of the hour, Dr. Kington. Thank you to everyone who has joined us. Whether you are coming from miles and miles away or a mere few steps from Foxcroft Hall, it is an honor to be here, gathered with all of you, celebrating the legacy of the Andover community.
2 years ago, as the COVID-19 epidemic scattered students away from campus, a moment like this seemed near impossible, and not just because it's 50 degrees in May, but because all of us are here. Looking around now, seeing all the friends and supporters of the Phillips Academy community is such a gift, and we cannot begin to express how much joy we feel.
Among us are alumni all the way from the class of 1948 to students in the class of 2025. Regardless of what year we graduated, though, if you look around, everyone here is Andover.
But what exactly does that mean, to be a part of Andover, to be a part of this shared legacy?
Our time away from school forced us to think about this a great deal. The fear of returning to a place we no longer recognized made it ever important to consider what exactly it was that made us fall in love with this place in the first place. The dream of bringing back the laughter and connection that seemed to come so naturally on the Great Lawn those first fall orientation days put the consideration of our school's foundations at the forefront of our agenda.
What we came up with after a great deal of reflection was nothing novel. In fact, our answer was found in the words carved into stone at the beginning of this institution. Non sibi, youth from every quarter, knowledge and goodness. These are phrases we have heard time and time again. And yes, we know what you must be thinking, how original. Fair enough, but we really believe in these values. They aren't just empty phrases. They're calls to action, setting forth the standard for what we should strive for. They're what unifies Andover. And while they've evolved over time, the essence of what they stand for remains, joining us together.
No matter the year, decade, century, era we find ourselves in, there are some constants for the Andover student. We find love for learning, not just in academic subjects, but also in the world around us and the people with whom we live alongside, because we are taught the beauty of knowledge and of diversity. We enjoy the minds, the presence, the vibes, for lack of a better word, of our peers, because we are a community that knows how to give and to appreciate. We have the best time of our lives here, because we are with people who prioritize goodness above all. And we never forget this place, no matter what type of life we live after graduation, because this is where we were shaped into the forever curious, driven, kind, open-minded, fun-loving people that we pride ourselves in being.
We make meaning in our lives and in the world through practicing these values. Take a moment and look around you. While each of our memories of this place may not be exactly alike, some of us remember Aisham as a student wellness center and some of us now live there, we find that the thread which transcends time and makes this community so tight-knit is our shared endeavor in the name of Andover's values.
Dr. Kington, you began your time at Andover during the onset of COVID-19. Certainly not an easy task. Yet, because of all the disconnection and uncertainty, Dr. Kington was also firsthand to witness the strength of Andover's spirit and firsthand witness to the way we persevere.
Dr. Kington, we are so grateful for the leadership you have demonstrated during your time here. Our hope is for the community on campus to continue rebuilding itself, not to return to normal, because let's face it, nothing is normal about this place. Footballers wear skirts on Fridays, but for it to reflect on the past few years, and as always has, to be guided by its values and grow to the world we live in.
We will soon be joining the alumni community, and while it will be bittersweet to leave campus, we are both so excited to see you lead Andover in familiar and in new directions.
Please give a big blue round of applause for Dr. Kington and for the String Quartet and Andover Dancers collaboration.
I was so entranced with the music. Welcome. Welcome, friends of Andover, students, faculty, staff, fellow trustees currently serving, and emeriti. Welcome, educators, Barbara, Bill, Rawson from Exeter, Temba, Mrs. Sizer. Welcome all of you who have contributed so much to the educational landscape that we treasure. To the investiture of our 16th head of school, Dr. Raynard Kington. As my friend and mentor, Peter Curry, noted when he welcomed John and Catherine Palfrey to the Academy, we don't do this very often. Now, only 16 times in our nearly 250-year history. But rare as these celebrations are, it is far more rare to hold one 2 years into the tenure of the serving head. Raynard's first fall was marked not by bagpipes and banners, but by antigen readers, plexiglass shields, and considerable fear and anxiety in our community. How could we deliver on the promise of an Andover education while keeping our community safe? What risks could we control and mitigate? Who would be hurt most by the twin risks of disease and isolation? So today is an opportunity not only to welcome you, Raynard, and Peter, and your boys to Andover Hill, but also to give thanks that we have come through the pandemic, that our worst fears were not realized, and that our students, faculty, and staff are regaining the normal, and I actually agree it belongs in quotes, Andover experience that perhaps we treasure all the more for having lost it, or at least parts of it, during these past 2 years. It is also a moment to give thanks to Jim Ventry, who led the school with courage and grace during the most difficult early days of the pandemic, and to thank all of our faculty and staff who gave so much to keep our students moving forward academically and emotionally in a period of tremendous loss and uncertainty. It is also an opportunity, Raynard, to highlight the ways in which your vision and leadership are already charting a course forward for the Academy. I think I can speak for the entire board that we all remember the day in the trustee room when you first came before us to discuss the prospect of becoming Andover's 16th head. You brought a well-worn copy of collections of essays by Claude Fees entitled Creed of a Schoolmaster. I think it's fair to say none of us had read it. But you had read it. And in your own quest to deepen your understanding of who and what this thing called Andover really was, and which you then quoted to us as we all listened in rapt attention. We saw clearly then that you combined a brilliant scientific mind schooled in the art of deep inquiry with a profound love for history. Perhaps it is that physician's spirit that seeks to promote and sustain that which is good and vital while addressing that which inhibits or undermines growth that characterizes your unique leadership. Since joining us in the summer of 2020, you have asked profound questions. What does academic excellence look like in the next decades? What does it mean to foster a diverse community in which all people feel that they are valued and can thrive? What is unique about students at this age and in this time? And how do we best nurture and challenge talented young people? And you have done more than ask questions. You have begun a process of rigorous inquiry with our faculty, aided by educational expertise from the RAND Corporation and elsewhere, as to the nature of excellence in teaching and curriculum for this new generation. You have renewed our commitment to teaching students how to think, not what to think, and you are shoring up resources to support students and families in their journey, including the creation of a new family liaison office, which will be led by Linda Carter Griffith. In all of these actions, you are already meeting the charge laid upon the head of school by our Constitution that the minds and morals of the youth under your charge will exceed every other care. Lastly, you have taken the bold step of creating a committee to consider our institutional history under the leadership of Chris Jones. You named the Committee on Challenging Histories at Andover. Much is made now of the divisive culture wars plaguing our democracy and the urge to cancel or delete or ignore that which upsets us or forces us to question our own thinking or opinions. Under your guidance, Raynard, Andover continues to forge a different path, one that is profoundly consistent with our history. Like all powerful language, this short phrase, challenging histories, punches way above its weight and conveys at least two important ideas. The first is the use of the word histories over history, to acknowledge that our common history is made up of many histories, and that history, even the history being written today as we gather on this beautiful but chilly lawn, while a dreadful war rages again in Europe, that history has and will always be complex. When we acknowledge many histories, we acknowledge the need to listen broadly and deeply. The second is to emphasize challenge. Here at Andover, we love challenge. We teach our young people all about it, often to the distress of their parents. We teach them to challenge themselves and their intellectual and physical capabilities. We teach them to challenge each other, to challenge received wisdom, and hopefully to meet the challenges of the history in which they will play a role, armed with goodness and knowledge. We seek challenge not for its own sake, but for the growth that comes from it. We use challenge to hone our understanding and to deepen our compassion. So in that short phrase, challenging histories, we seem to recognize that every generation and every society sees but in part, and that the search for complete truth is everlasting. So we continue with this long journey, with open minds and hearts, with a common commitment to valuing the other, and with a true thirst for understanding. That is what Andover offers and why we treasure this institution. Because while Andover has and will stray from the narrow path of wisdom, it will always strive towards it. We celebrate today the newest chapter in that striving history, and we thank Raynard and his family for the service already done and for the years yet to come. It is therefore with distinct pleasure that on behalf of the Board of Trustees and by virtue of the authority vested in the Board of Trustees by the Constitution of Phillips Academy and by the Act of Incorporation granted by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, I hereby declare you, Raynard Kington, the head of school of Phillips Academy, in recognition and as evidence of your induction and installation, the Board of Trustees bestows upon you, as insignia of your official authority, a replica of the seal of Phillips Academy designed by Paul Revere. Yeah, I don't know if it's big and heavy.
It's big and heavy.
Thank you, Amy. Good morning, and welcome to another beautiful day at Andover. On behalf of my friends and colleagues on the faculty and staff, it is indeed my pleasure to present a special gift to Dr. Raynard Kington on the occasion of his investiture as the 16th head of school. The gift is an engraved wooden box, which will hold the Elephalet Pearson. Here it is. This gift is engraved, an engraved wooden box which will hold the Elephalet Pearson gavel and was handmade by Strother Purdy, Andover class of 1985. Strother is a talented craftsman who made other significant carved wooden items and gifts from fallen campus trees for the Academy. Strother's works include the Afladam table, presented at the Afladam 50th anniversary in 2018, and some of the classroom tables in Bullfinch Hall. On top of the box is an engraving. It's a quote from Cecil Bancroft, the eighth head of school of Phillips Academy from 1873 to 1901, from a fallen maple tree next to Bancroft Hall, our beloved dormitory on Old Campus Road in West Quad North, named after Cecil Bancroft, Strother Purdy has crafted this box. The quote reads, "Nothing in this world is more stable, nothing more sure to do good than educational foundations." This quote is taken from Cecil Bancroft's speech at the first biennial dinner of the New York Alumni Association of Phillips Academy at the Hotel Brunswick in New York City in March of 1891. From our archives, we learn that Cecil Bancroft had arrived at Andover when the Academy's funds were low, student enrollment was decreasing, and the school's reputation was falling. During his tenure, Bancroft increased the size of the faculty, vastly improved the physical plant, and added significantly to the endowment, all of which improved the quality of education at Andover. Dr. Kington has shared that he has developed an affinity for and kinship with the writings of Cecil Bancroft, who, by the way, was also a graduate and trustee of Dartmouth College, my alma mater, thank you. Under Dr. Kington's leadership, the Academy's funds are well managed. Student enrollment is on target, and the demand for the Andover experience has never been more robust. In your time, Dr. Kington, you have had to cope with disappointments and losses and the challenges of leading our school during the dual pandemic of social injustice, which has overshadowed Andover and our country. I'm sorry, Raynard, but I think Cecil had it easy. Throughout these past couple of years, you have displayed determination, courage, humility, and compassion, and those qualities align with the culture of Andover. With all the care and attention you have devoted to Andover and with the support of the entire Board of Trustees, please internalize the familiar fact that you have been chosen. You have been selected. You were decided upon, and there is no ambiguity. You are right for Andover, and you have earned your place, and you are here for a reason. Dr. Kington's unwavering commitment to helping others and expressing empathy to those most vulnerable make him an extraordinary leader for our times. During these disruptive and turbulent past couple of years, Dr. Kington has quickly become Andover's symbol of hope. On behalf of my friends and colleagues and the faculty and staff, we extend to you this special gift on the occasion of your investiture. Nothing in this world is more stable, nothing more sure to do good than educational foundations. Thank you. Dr. Kington, to you. Now you have that. Oh, here we come. Okay, thank you.
dark night. And I've been waiting for this morning.
It's been a long, hard fight, but I see a brand new day dawning. I've been looking for sunshine, 'cause I ain't seen it in so long. Everything's gonna work out fine. Everything's gonna be alright. It's gonna be okay.
We're having some discussion.
So, the words I am about to read are those of John G. Palfrey, who served as the 15th head of school at Phillips Academy from 2012 to 2019. John was unable to be here, but in his message containing the words I'm about to read, John wrote, "Dear friends, I am heartbroken to be in Chicago and not on Andover Hill. I know that these events of the next few days are in good hands, but still, I attach these remarks I had prepared for passing the Eliphalet Pearson gavel, hewing closely to what Barbara Chase said when she passed the gavel to me. Warmly, John. Here is the prestigious gavel, which John Palfrey passed to me when I served as 15.5 interim head of school. And as I had to say many times that year, and I'll say it again now, I am not John Palfrey. But I am privileged and honored to read these words. This gavel symbolizes the responsibilities attendant to the position of head of school at Phillips Academy. Since 1778, only 15 of us have held this post. Each has committed to the lofty values, dedication to excellence, and unique culture of Andover. Raynard Kington has joined that succession as its 16th member. Through the centuries, Dr. Kington's position has carried many names: master, preceptor, principal, headmaster, and head of school. Throughout these and other changes, our highest duty has remained constant. Quote, the first and principal duty of the master, our Constitution states, is to regulate the tempers, to enlarge the minds, and form the morals of the youth committed to his care. Raynard Kington possesses the knowledge and goodness to carry on the finest traditions of this academy. His appointment ushers in a new and promising era at this institution, nearly 250 years in its existence. It is with great joy and hope that I proudly pass on the Eliphalet Pearson gavel, just one symbol of another great beginning at Andover. Finis origine pendet. Congratulations.
Thank you. That was a great introduction and lovely words, and incredible performances by the students. Thank you, faculty, staff, faculty emeriti, and students and trustees and alumni and families. Thank you for helping to celebrate this remarkable institution. Amy, thank you for opening my eyes to a very special opportunity and for your unwavering partnership. As you may know, Amy is the first woman president of the board of trustees either of Abbott or of Phillips Andover, so she too is making history. I'd like to thank a few people who have been particularly influential in my journey. First, my late parents, Mildred Shavers Kington and Dr. Garfield Douglas Kington. My parents gave me among the greatest gifts parents can give a child. They gave me an emancipated mind to imagine a life and a career different from theirs and different from anyone around me growing up. They also imbued in me a deep respect for the incomparable power of an educated mind. I'd also like to thank two of my mother's sisters. My late Aunt Myrtle was my mother's twin. She and my Uncle Bernard were especially kind and supportive when I entered the University of Michigan 1 month after I turned 16. They regularly drove from Detroit to Ann Arbor to take me to dinner and to check on me, and I later learned to report back to my parents. I'd also like to thank my Aunt Maddie, who is 102 years old and is watching this from Nashville, Tennessee. Finally, I'd like to thank my spouse, Dr. Peter Daniolos, without whose love and support I would not be here, and our children, Emerson and Basile, who overcame their initially very strongly negative response when told of the possibility of our family moving from the small town in Iowa where they had spent the bulk of their lives. I think they have mostly forgiven us. You know, I struggle with this speech in part because I'm uncomfortable with any ceremony with me at the center. There were 1,000 reasons why we did not need to have an investiture, and I tried every single one of them. Yet I remembered something my mother had told me when I was a teenager and making another snarky remark about an old-fashioned minister that I didn't like, who was a minister of her church, and expressing dismay that she could remain a member of that church. She told me in her best elementary school teacher voice that the church was not the minister. It was the people, all of the people, from the very beginning of the church to the present. The minister at any one point in time is a small, small slice of the church. So I was reminded that though I am the one being invested, I'm really a small slice in the arc of this school, which of course includes the history of Abbott and the merger of Phillips and Abbott to become one. When I think of the people of this community and its mission and its history, I found that notion reassuring. Another cause for my struggle was that I was uncomfortable with celebrations of beginnings, whether a beginning such as an investiture or an anniversary of a beginning, or even birthdays. Now, in 1987, when the country was celebrating the 200th anniversary of the Constitution, I was a faculty fellow at Du Bois College House at Penn. And in spite of the close proximity to the place where that document was ratified, I couldn't feel any celebratory mood, and in fact, I found the celebration pretty irritating. Perhaps I was uncomfortable with the event because it was just 1 year after the infamous Bowers v. Hardwick Supreme Court decision upholding the Georgia law making intimate homosexual relations between consenting adults illegal. That ruling had a concurring opinion written by Chief Justice Warren Burger, who was the chair of the committee that oversaw the celebrations for the 1987 anniversary. Or maybe I was just channeling the traditional African-American discomfort with blindly celebrating many elements of the history of this country when the gap between its ideals and its reality, even today, is so well known by our community. During that time, one of my heroes, Thurgood Marshall, gave a speech about that bicentennial celebration that was defiantly not in line with the general tenor of what everyone else was saying. I thought a lot about that speech recently. Most notably, Marshall said that he refused to celebrate the flawed document that is the Constitution. He said this about the changes in the Constitution that followed the so-called miracle in Philadelphia. He said, "The men who gathered in Philadelphia in 1787 could not have envisioned these changes. They could not have imagined, nor would they have accepted that the document that they were drafting would one day be construed by a Supreme Court to which had been appointed a woman and the descendant of an African slave. We, the people, no longer enslave, but the credit does not belong with the framers. It belongs to those who refuse to acquiesce in outdated notions of liberty, justice, and equality, and who strive to better them." He went on to say, "The true miracle was not the birth of the Constitution, but its life." I love that idea, celebrating the life of the Constitution rather than its birth. It allowed me to find a place for myself in that celebration in 1987, and it's helped me find a place for myself in this celebration. So I see this investiture not as a celebration that's about my beginning, but as instead a celebration of the life of this institution. A way to note that this school has made it this far and has changed so much, just as our Constitution has, and that someone like me could be appointed to lead this school. I see the celebration as a turning of the page from one chapter to another in the long life of this great school. I know that there are those who see my appointment as the first African-American head and the first openly gay head as especially notable, and I do as well. I never forget that I am where I am, not only because I worked hard, but because countless other people sacrificed to open doors that I could walk through. If the ceremony had been taking place 10, 5, or even 3 years ago, I would have stopped there in commenting on the significance of what is notable about my appointment. Even 3 years ago, I would not have focused my comments on my race or sexual orientation, not because I am in any way uncomfortable with those elements of who I am, quite the contrary, but the shifts in our national discourse and our deep societal divisions with respect to race and sexual orientation and gender that are manifesting daily serve as a stark reminder that we can never rest, that no rights or privileges are guaranteed forever, that we must fight to keep them. The need to be vigilant remains because the time when my appointment would have been unthinkable is not that long ago. We are living in a troubling time when some people do not like where we have arrived as a democratic society and where we might be headed, when some people are surely not thrilled by my double first status. They do not want to stand athwart history and yell stop. They want to barricade before history with weapons drawn, spewing bigotry, and yelling turn around, turn back. They want us to return to a flawed memory of a past America that existed as great only in the minds of a few. Great for whom? We will not go back. We can't go back. Because of places like Phillips Academy, whose constitution espouses the crucial unity of knowledge and goodness, we will not go back. Our minds and our knowledge and our experiences and our imaginations will help us to continue to move forward. That is a testament to the power of education. The opening of the doors I have walked through is deeply tied to the power of knowledge, of education, like the transformative education that Phillips Academy has provided for almost 250 years. There's a reason why it was against the law to teach my great-grandparents to read and write as enslaved people. Those who benefited from that wretched institutional slavery knew the power of opening a mind, the power of knowledge that so clearly gave lie to racist notions of a hierarchy of humans. And that is why my great-grandparents and so many others worked so hard to make sure their children were educated. We are not going back. So today, we are celebrating all the people who brought this institution this far, who helped this institution step by step to move closer to the more noble ideals that are at the base of our school's originating constitution and our country's constitution. I want to especially celebrate all those who helped this school change and constantly aspire to become better, to remain relevant, to lead in a changing world. It seems only appropriate that today marks the first time that the head of school investiture is held on Richard T. Greener Quadrangle, named after the first African-American graduate of this school. This iconic location was named through the generosity of an anonymous donor and honors the legacy of one of America's trailblazing advocates for racial equality. A member of the Phillips Academy class of 1865 and a deeply loyal alumnus, Richard T. Greener was an active and notable voice for the rights of African Americans during and after the Reconstruction period. He served as both the dean of Howard University's law school and associate editor of Frederick Douglass's newspaper, New National Era. A scholar and a teacher, a lawyer and a diplomat, he led by example and he touched the lives of faculty and students of this institution. When we speak about Greener, we often note that he was also the first black graduate of Harvard. But there's another part of his life that is more painful to remember, but worth reminding ourselves about today. Several years after he graduated from Harvard, he became the first black faculty member of the University of South Carolina, the only public university in the South that integrated during Reconstruction. He also became the librarian of the school, went to law school, and was among the first black graduates of the University of South Carolina Law School. But as Reconstruction came to an end, Greener had to leave that university after it was closed and reopened once again as an all-white school. Rights and privileges can be taken away, as Greener's were. Of course, there's no doubt that we've made incredible progress over the history of this school. That progress is a testament to the faculty's devotion to Andover's mission and to their willingness to remain nimble, themselves being students of the craft of teaching. It is also a testament to those who came before me and ably led this school during rewarding times and challenging times. Just think about the recent history in the nearly 25 years of leadership between Barbara Landis Chase and John Pulford. You quickly understand what is necessary to keep pace and evolve with the time. All of this to meet our mission in the service of students. And my taking this position is also real evidence of continued progress. But at this time, when dishonest narratives of stolen elections are used to justify restrictive voting rights, when leaders energize voters with their homophobic and transphobic rhetoric, the education we offer has never been more important. And I believe that an essential part of that education is the free engagement with ideas, including ideas that some of us may find odious. I don't aim for a false notion of neutrality. I'm not neutral on many controversial issues, especially those that are tied to our values and our mission. For those issues in particular, we as an institution should not strive to be neutral. Not all ideas are equally valid or important or true. But I believe in engaging with those odious ideas because bringing them into the light is the only way to demonstrate what is wrong about them. I welcome that engagement because I am confident that openness will lead to better ideas, ideas that will help us to continue to bend the moral arc of the universe toward justice. I have tried in my comments today to walk a fine line, to be honest about how I feel about the time in which this investiture is taking place, this perilous moment we are in as a nation, but also to show that I am hopeful because I am hopeful. So I will end with a piece from The Fire Next Time, written by James Baldwin, another of my heroes. He wrote, "It began to seem that one would have to hold in the mind forever two ideas which seemed to be in opposition. The first idea was acceptance, the acceptance totally without rancor of life as it is and men as they are. In the light of this idea, it goes without saying that injustice is a commonplace. But this did not mean that one could be complacent, for the second idea was of equal power, that one must never, in one's own life, accept these injustices as commonplace, but must fight them with all one's strength. This fight, however, begins in the heart. And now it had been laid to my charge to keep my own heart free of hatred and despair." Great schools exist right at that intersection that Baldwin described so eloquently, at that point of tension, the intersection of helping our students to understand the world as it is, with all of its flaws, with ideas that make us uncomfortable, and sometimes with painful knowledge that can even tempt us to hate and despair, while at the same time empowering students with hope, hope that is grounded in knowledge, with the intellectual tools to change what needs to be changed, to change what is wrong with our beautiful, broken world. And we must help our students to discern the truth. Today, the truth is that it is hard for many of us to keep from despairing. But whenever I'm in one of those moods, all I have to do is walk across this beautiful campus and see our faculty and our staff who make this place work, and our students, especially their diversity, their intelligence, their eagerness to explore and understand the world around them in all of its complexity. Seeing them is all that I need to renew my faith in the future of this extraordinary country and this extraordinary institution's place in this country and the world. Our incredible students are my hope. They're the reason why I get up every day and cross Maine after pushing the crossing button, and walk across the great lawn past the sign for Greener Quad, enter George Washington Hall, and sit at my desk and begin my day. They make it all worthwhile. Thank you for listening.
Thank you once again to everyone for being here today. Thank you to our student performers. Thank you to the members of the Board of Trustees, faculty, students, alumni. Mary and Sean, thank you for your opening. And Dr. Kington, thank you for your words. We know you did not want a big celebration, but it's not every day that Andover, our home, gets to celebrate a new leader and begin a new chapter of its extensive history. Nigel cannot be here for this momentous occasion, but I can promise you that he is beyond envious that I get to be here while he takes the treacherous SAT. And as for me, I am truly incredibly honored to stand before you here today. Though ceremonial nature, this feels to me like a true turning of the page, an anticipated beginning for Dr. Kington and a new one for an Andover generation that now finds itself with a unique opportunity to build its own legacy. In line with the school's founding values, but individual to the challenges and goals of our students for years to come. There is so much happening both on and beyond our campus today. Recent events have triggered national reckonings of racial justice and have spurred the beginnings of an institutional recognition of our own complicated histories. Climate advocacy has consistently challenged us to confront the truth of climate change and our role in condoning it. And for the past 2 years, our community has been fragmented and divided by the pandemic. As we embark on our journey together, it is our hope that you could lead alongside us. It is one thing to govern an institution and an entirely different one to govern its people. It is our hope that together we can reckon with the findings of the Anti-Racism Task Force report, that together we can encourage and influence Andover's leadership in sustainability and climate action, that together we can challenge monolithic definitions of leadership, that together we can forge a new path towards a better blue. We stand here connected as an Andover community. We have all shared, I'm sure, the hope upon our very first steps on campus. We have all shared the awe as we gaze upon Sam Phil for the first and maybe last time as students here. We have all shared the excitement for the unknown future, as well as nostalgia for memories past. Let us share another moment together, here and now. Dr. Kington, we trust in your leadership. We trust that you will do right by us and our community by taking on the job of head of school. We cannot be more excited for your tenure, and we cannot wait to see the way that you will shape our beloved school. Thank you. Thank you.
Good morning, Andover. Good morning. On the regular, these steps are unremarkable. Students and faculty run up them early and late for Japanese or History 300. Sometimes they make an excellent outdoor classroom for EBI or Spanish. And just last week, they were the perfect place for students sharing personal stories and ardent passions to make this place and the world better. More just, more green, safer for all. Once a year, these steps are notable for commencing informal ceremony, much like today, with bagpipes and roses, prizes and prayers. A little bit warmer, I must confess. Far less often, these steps become extraordinary, bearing up leadership transitions with promise, pledge, charge and blessing, carrying hopes and dreams of generations present and to come for the endurance of a school that becomes home. And every so often, these steps host something truly exceptional that no one in generations past might ever have dreamed could be. This morning, with fierce winds that usher in change and a new day, is such an occasion. August already at the outset, the context and the details of this morning shift the tectonic plates of this campus. A new leader in this time, in this place, we who gather tie bonds of promise and vision to work together for an Andover of today and tomorrow. I have been witness to such noteworthy occasion on these steps once before, decades ago, when the title of headmaster had to move to head of school, to be more inclusive of what leadership might look like. So this day, may our gathering please the spirits of long ago past and yet to come future. May the holiness of all beings and the grandiosity of God look upon us and declare that it is good, with whom God is well pleased. May we who gather from many traditions and varied sacred paths, we who know you in nature, on mountaintop and in sand mandalas, we who know you in glittering cathedral or plain meeting house, in sacred mosque and holy synagogue, who have considered you mystery and professed we know not. We unite now as one Andover family bound to be blessing and promise for this chapter now unfolding. Aware of the awesome and challenging history on which we stand, while always on watch for our next clear blue morning. Let us take to this day in all the ways that it is unremarkable, notable, extraordinary, exceptional, and noteworthy. Go in peace to love and to serve and to be a blessing to the world. Amen.